Hi, this is Christian Espinoza with Alpine Security. In today's video, we're going to cover the hacking methodology. I want to be clear that a methodology is just a series of steps. There is no exact methodology you must or have to follow for ethical hacking or penetration testing. The methodology I'm using here today as an example is Alpine Security's methodology. And again, this is very high level. This doesn't go into detail like what we do for a wireless penetration test versus a web application penetration test as an example. So phase one of the hacking methodology, and this is often the most overlooked phase. Phase one is planning and preparation. This is like very critical and vital for a penetration test. Part of this phase is identifying the objective of the test. What is the objective? A lot of penetration testers will just go in and start hacking stuff without understanding the objective. The purpose of phase one, the planning and preparation, is to identify that objective. This is typically done during the kickoff meeting with the client. During the kickoff meeting, you go over the objectives of the test, anything specific the client is looking for, and you also go over the rules of engagement document as well as authorization document. To do an ethical hack or a penetration test, you need signed authorization from the client that you're going to do the test against. You also should follow and create and fill out together and agree upon the rules of engagement. This will cover things such as what is in scope for the test, what the testing parameters are, such as the times you're allowed to do the test, what happens if you discover that the target or the client is already compromised during the test. Do you continue on with the test, or do you notify them, as example? Who's your points of contact? You should have at least two. And all of those things should be clearly articulated in the rules of engagement document. That is a very critical document for a penetration test. Phase two is reconnaissance and discovery. Generally, in phase two, we have passive reconnaissance, which means we don't actually touch the target. We use tools such as Google Hacking Database, Shodan, or just Google searches or observation for passive reconnaissance. Active reconnaissance means we are interacting with the target, that we are touching the target, and our actions could be attributable back to us. Tools used with active reconnaissance could be Nmap, could be Nessus, could be Burp Suite, any tool that touches the target that gives us information about that target. Part of the reconnaissance and discovery phase as well is figuring out a prioritized target list. So as you're going through and discovering targets, you kind of figure out which targets are a web server, which targets might be a domain controller, and you kind of get an idea what the landscape is like. Based on that, you can start prioritizing the target list. Phase three is vulnerability enumeration / analysis. So in this phase, you take the information you gathered from phase two, discovery, and you start figuring out what vulnerabilities may exist in the targets you've already identified or discovered. Then you analyze those vulnerabilities and map those vulnerabilities to exploits. You have to have a vulnerability in order to exploit something. This could be a missing patch on a web server. It could be a door that people leave open for too long, like if you're observing people walking into a building and there's a delay between when the door opens and when it closes, then that could be a vulnerability as well. So you have to have a vulnerability before you can exploit it. And part of this phase three is also looking at what type of exploits could work. This is the mapping part against those vulnerabilities. If there is a missing patch on a web server, as I mentioned, you might be able to use, you know, a specific Metasploit framework module to exploit that vulnerability. Then you want to prioritize the targets to exploit. So now that you've got the list of targets, you know the vulnerabilities, you know the exploits that will work against those vulnerabilities, you need to prioritize that target list based on which targets will most likely get you closer to the objective of the penetration test. You don't need to go through and exploit every single vulnerability out there. You need to focus on the ones that make sense based on your objective of the test. Phase four. Before I go to phase four, I think I mentioned a couple tools for phase three are Nessus, OpenVAS, Burp Suite. Those are a few tools you can use for phase three. for phase four, initial exploitation. This is where we exploit the targets based on our prioritized target list. We call this initial exploitation because in phase five, which we'll see in a minute, we want to expand our foothold. So this is like the initial way into a facility or into a system. This involves compromising the target. So if I'm talking about that door that's left open in that building, one way to exploit that might be to, if someone walks in the facility and the door is like slowly closing, to put my foot in the door and tailgate behind them into the facility. That's the initial exploitation. Now, what do I do when I'm in that building? Typically, that doesn't mean like I'm done with a test, I've got in the building. There's often some sort of information you have to get, some sort of data or something else you need to do while you're in the building. So that's the initial exploitation, though, is getting in the building. And while you get in the building, as example, you can start looking around and performing additional reconnaissance. Phase five is expanding your foothold or deeper penetration. So now that we've obtained initial exploitation, we've got our foot in the door, we've got into the building, or we've exploited a operating system, the next thing you want to do is like expand our foothold. So now that we're into the building, as an example, I look around and let's say I notice there's a Cat 5 jack over there and there's a power outlet pretty close to that. So one of the things I can do to expand my foothold is maybe put a Pwn plug in there, which means when I leave the building, I may be able to have remote access to that facility and that network. So that would be expanding your foothold. Another way of doing this is escalating privileges. So if I exploit a vulnerability on that web application, I may only have like user level permission or whatever permission that the service is running on the application. So one way to expand the foothold is to escalate the privileges, which means I would run an additional exploit to get like administrator or root level permission on that system. And then from there, I can configure what's called a pivot point, which allows me to pivot from the compromised system to other systems. So this is very useful if I'm able to compromise a system that is dual homed or has access to an internal environment. So if I can compromise, like say a web server that's connected to the internet, it's public facing, but it also has a connection to a DMZ, for instance, internally. If I can pivot off of that system, then I can, from there, attack the internal systems on the DMZ. So that's the deeper penetration testing part. And then ideally through these phases, you accomplish the objective. Phase six is to clean up everything you've done, basically. Since this is a penetration test, you want to go through and any files you left on a system, any artifacts you left, anything you did as part of your test, you want to clean that up. Then you want to verify the system state is pre-test, and this involves a lot of coordination with the client typically at this point, because once you're doing the cleanup, the test is typically over, and you've already accomplished the objective, as we mentioned in 5.3 there. Phase 7 is when you write the report. So as you're going through these first six phases, you should be adding data to the report, and then phase 7 is really when you finalize the report and consolidate everything. You also want to prioritize the findings for the report. Not every finding is equal, so the findings should be prioritized based on risk, which is the likelihood times the impact. Then typically you'll present the report to the client. We at Alpine Security do it via Zoom session. We also obviously send the report to the client as well. So this was just a high level overview of the penetration testing methodology, or the ethical hacking methodology. The one I went over here is seven phases, and this is what we use at Alpine Security. And this is just the high level stuff we use. We actually, you know, dig a lot deeper. When we talk about, as a quick example here, of compromising the targets, there's really a lot behind that, because if it's a web application or mobile device or wireless or physical, that we have different methodologies for how to compromise each of those. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you have any questions or comments, you can leave them beneath the video. Thanks for watching.